wynik!
Nie wyjdę! Róbcie, co chcecie!
Put your hands up.
No.
Right under a light, his shadow is the densest, but also the tiniest. Then, when he starts to move, his shadow grows in front of him. The shadow becomes bigger and bigger while it thins out.
I felt so bad for what I did.
Oh my God. See now your faithful servant as he lies in great weakness, and bless him with everlasting life.
Julien Donkey Boy was perhaps the film that opened my eyes the most in regards to conventionally outdated or intentionally cheap methods of capture serving a higher purpose. This sort of appeal in film can of course be compared to the whole return to old school or vintage stuff phenomenon. Using Polaroids or sporting 1950s-esque fashion is suddenly cool. Claiming to have been born in the wrong generation to either feel unique or indulge in a facade of pseudo-nostalgia. Or perhaps discovering and appreciating an additional layer of beauty in aspects that are generally considered flaws due to technological advancements. That's certainly the case for me with films incorporating cheap equipment or outdated methods for the sake of symbolism, style, or just a different experience. A different kind of view on beauty, in itself being a different kind of beauty. That's how I view Julien Donkey Boy. All of the tiny grain particles moving around as if in a symphonic manner. The choppy slow motion pulling focus onto singular frames rather than a fluid motion. The beautiful classical music blending itself into a different aesthetic and time. Feeling so well adjusted in these traditional yet contemporary moments. There seems to be a general craving of striving for perfection in presentation nowadays, which obviously I find quite overrated. A lot of the aspiring filmmakers I come across seem to strive for perhaps not the most realistic effect, but the most professional looking. And I just don't get it. What is the point in mimicking something that has already been accomplished multiple times before in such a bland manner? Now, don't get me wrong, I'm not just being a contrarian opposing well-made short films that also happen to look great. I'm opposing the apparent trend of, you have to use an expensive camera and focus on the focusing, have a widescreen aspect ratio and throw in some fancy filters for good measure to make it look professional, being implemented into any young filmmaker's work nowadays. There's nothing wrong with applying these techniques, but why does it seem to be the standard, and more often than not, the main visual attraction? Just to show off that we can achieve the same thing as big studios but without a huge budget? How about actually showing off your unique vision, bringing something new to the table, rebelling yet innovating, instead of just showing that you can indeed conform, just like a lot of other people, to the expected standards of the industry? There's definitely a stigma of coming across as cringeworthy with a whole generation of insecure people not developing due to that overused label. When most of the time we should be adapting to certain imperfections in someone's style, seeing them as positive and innovative elements rather than distracting and negative.
My mom told me when I was 6 years old that all I have to do is grab the energy. I don't have the strength, I don't have the body, I have to have the energy.
I grab the steak and that's it.
No, that's not it. It's energy.
Look at her.
See, she's got the energy.
Yeah. But it's backwards. This is the Rittberger.
I don't know what it is. Who cares what it is? Look at her do that, see?
This is why the Dogma 95 movement was so important, and clearly still is, as years later it's continuing to have a great influence in the world of film and on people like myself. Focusing on general authenticity, reinforcing the significance of the core filmmaking elements, and taking advantage of aspects or methods that are generally considered to be disadvantageous, for the sake of effective storytelling or more. And more is definitely what Julien Donkey Boy accomplishes. Despite being a movement designed to bring back the power of a director as an artist, and to encourage focus on the traditional values of cinema rather than having the comfort of post-production modifications molding the film, the Dogma 95 manifesto does include rules that break even the traditional elements of filmmaking. In particular, the restrictions on music and the director not being credited, although that particular rule is a bit of a blur. And yet, Harmony Korine broke rules even within the Dogma 95 manifesto, while still passing for the certificate and even receiving praise from Lars von Trier himself. Hell, all of the most notable filmmakers of the movement were breaking rules, which is honestly just charming. Lars being self-reflective on restrictions not only in an actual film, but also in a groundbreaking movement, both of which he collaborated on with friends. Going back to the point I was making though, the biggest non-written rule Korine broke was not focusing on one of the three main elements the movement was promoting. Continuing on from Gummo, he decided to embrace the motive of capturing snippets of life rather than telling a grounded story. And more so than he achieved with Gummo, broke new ground as an auteur as well as in the world of cinema. Not every film needs to follow a conventional story, or a story at all for that matter. A collection of moments, whether tragic, tender, or both, can be just as captivating as a coherent story.
Kiss mommy, I love funky nice baby.
Despite not establishing or following through of a grounded story, there is certainly a consistent pattern with the absurdist humor, mostly coming from the father, the blind seeing more, or generally the disabled being more able, awaiting pregnancy to extend one's craving for caring, familial sentimentality despite everything, and of course the exploration of schizophrenia in relation to family life, or, as I see it, the effects of any disability on the stability of family life and love. I think Roger Ebert summed it up very well. If you stay with it, the pattern emerges from the jumble. Essentially encouraging people to give something that may come across as just a mess, a genuine chance, so that after a feeling of disdain for the lack of conventional storytelling, they can notice a pattern to follow, transitioning from simply staying with it to being enchanted by it, and as a result, eventually experiencing a shattering culmination. A lot of the intensity and suspense during the film is built up using sheer weirdness. more often than not, for a positively fueled type of weirdness. But in a scene in which a father keeps encouraging his son to put on his deceased wife's wedding dress because he looks the most like her, disturbing intentions naturally come to mind.
Why don't you take this dress?
No, we do it.
Belonged to your mom.
Yeah?
She wore it when we got married. Why don't you put it on? It's very nice. You're the only one who looks like your mother.
A true conclusion is never really provided for this. The son continually declines, and the father is left dancing on his own while wearing a gas mask. Does this indicate that his wife died in a tragedy? A real or made-up one? Was the father planning on only dancing with his son, with the likeness to his wife only being a craving for a more authentic fleeting recreation of sentimental memories? These questions are intentionally left unanswered. Not due to bad writing, but for the sake of examining the tragedy that is schizophrenia. Blurry in its absurdity, yet clear as light in its emotional authenticity. The sadness, passion, and desperation all feel as real as they can, despite all of the facade in between. Aside from the low quality of digital video complementing each shadow or bit of darkness with its grain, as well as overall providing a very specific visual output, the aesthetic present here naturally provokes a sense of nostalgia for me, and likely for many people that had the privilege of recording video rather than just taking pictures during their childhood. Popular media and film had that professional look, whereas home videos had this look. And most of the segments in this film, such as the joyful group wrapping up a harmony or the brothers' wrestling practice shenanigans, do feel like authentic home videos. I know that might not sound like the most expert form of filmmaking. Having a somewhat loose script, filming intriguing people or interactions with a digital camera and rolling with it, I guess. But think about this. Why do you love watching those nostalgic clips and family home videos? Initially due to the memorable or funny things captured in them, sure. But the people featured are the primary element. You reminisce partly about the changes in a particular location, but mainly about the people you interacted with there. The people are what make the home videos compelling. So why do people that I've never met in my life feel as compelling to watch as the people I've known all my life? That's the power of film.
At the midpoint between the lampposts, the pain is so great, it outweighs my pleasure. And with every step forward, pleasure dissolves, and pain intensifies behind me. Finally, the pain is so unbearably intense that I have to act.
I know you want to be someone special, but let's face it. This illustration can be used for any addict's tale of woe. The alcoholic empties the bottle and it's sadly the chaitera chaitera. But what about the family?